Welcome back to Sister Circle Live. He is a gospel music giant who's blessed us with classics like Center of My Joy, Hallelujah, Angels, and Total Praise.
But a successful run in music couldn't push him past his demons, demons that came in the form of depression, suicidal thoughts, and hopelessness. And he pins it all in his new autobiography, Total Praise. Please welcome the living legend, Richard Smallwood.
Yes! Thank you so much. Good to have you here.
Oh, it's great to be here.
Yes. Thank
you. Before we jump into the book and everything it has to offer, we know that this is Black History Month. Can you talk about one of the most epic Black History musical moments that you've ever experienced?
You know, for me, I think it's when Aretha sang for President Barack Obama's inauguration.
Yeah.
That was wonderful.
Yes.
It was amazing.
Good. Gives you chills still.
Absolutely.
Richard, you have been abundantly transparent in your new book, Total Praise.
Right.
Talk about all of your battles with mental health. Why do you think this time is so appropriate to release the book, and how long did it take you to finish it?
It took me about 5 years plus to write the book. I think it's important because I think mental health is something that has a stigma.
Yes.
Depression, anxiety, which is something I dealt with since I was a child. And I think it's time to talk about it and help release a lot of those people who are dealing with and take some of the stigma and some of the shame away from it.
Absolutely.
Yes. And Richard, I don't mean to pry, but you know, I'm very curious. This book is pretty thick here.
It is.
When did you start having trouble, those troubling thoughts? And when did you know that I have to do something about them now?
It started when I was a child. My anxiety, I didn't know what it was. You know, nobody in the African-American community knew what that was, you know, but I knew there was something wrong. But I wasn't really diagnosed till like 1999, when they really put a name on it. And I was ashamed at first, you know, but when I started writing my memoirs, I said, you know, I really need to address this because I think so many people are bound by it.
Well, you know, part of overcoming trauma is uncovering it.
Yes.
So at what point in your life did you say, you know what, I am going to beat this, I'm not going to let it beat me.
Right.
And to say, okay, I have mental illness and I am going to forage on and tell my story.
Well, I knew I had to get help. After a while, when I couldn't leave the house, when I couldn't do the regular things that I do, you know, during the day, I said, I've got to get help.
Yeah.
So I went out to a therapist, and that's where the whole treatment started. Mm-hmm. And it gave me more strength, it gave me more courage to even talk about it to others.
Right.
And how were you able to, I guess at a point you had to mask it through your music and your faith. Can you talk about that duality?
I masked it for years.
Yeah.
I mean, I would sing on stage, minister on stage, and I was wonderful as long as I was on stage, but as soon as I came off and went to the hotel, it was just darkness, you know? And I was afraid to tell anybody because I didn't want people to think I was weak or think I wasn't a Christian, you know what I'm saying?
Mm-hmm. Right.
So I just wanted to take some of the mystery and some of the fear and some of the stigma off of what this is and tell people if you're suffering, get help. Pray, but get help.
Yeah.
Reach out to a mental health professional.
Well, you talk about anxiety, and you know, we know that a lot of times doctors are so quick to prescribe medicine. You know, some people take Xanax to kind of relax them and volumes and all of that. You know, what or did you indulge in that? And or if not, what kept you away from going that route in terms of self-medicating?
Oh, yes. I'm on medication now, and I'm glad about it. Because it made a difference in my life. And that's one of the things that I wanted to talk about. It depends on your issue and what you're dealing with, whether you have to go to medication or not. But I was extremely depressed.
Right.
And that's something that I had to do, and it's made 100%.
But you never reverted to self-medicating alcohol. Abusing
honestly,
prescription drugs.
Honestly, I went through that for a little while, especially the alcohol.
Yeah.
I did. I got off my medication thinking, oh, I got this.
I got this.
And little, by increments, the depression started creeping back up.
Yes.
And I drank, you know, to mask it. Until finally I had a breakdown. I was like, you know, I've got to get back into getting somebody to help me.
Yeah. Wow. Goodness. Well, listen, if you're sticking around for the full hour, we'll be talking more with Richard Smallwood about his new powerful book, Total Praise, when we return. And the conversation's always continued. Sister Circle TV on all social media platforms.
Wow. This song right here.
That's a good one.
It has lifted my soul in so many scenarios.
God bless you.
Yes, can't wait to talk about it more.
We are back on Sister Circle Live with the living legend himself, Richard Smallwood, and we're continuing our conversation about his insightful new book, Total Praise.
Amen. Yes, Thank you so much.
You know, during that time when you were in your darkest days and had your darkest moments, how were you able to continue to push through and still provide amazing music that uplift the spirits of everyone else? And at times, your own music, did you find your music was therapeutic for yourself?
Absolutely. Okay. Yeah. There was, sometimes those words would come back to minister to you in a way they had not ministered when you wrote it. You know, you weren't going through those things when you wrote it. And God has a way of bringing those words back in those lyrics to minister you.
Yeah.
But, you know, I think that God got me through it.
Yeah.
You know, because my prayer life, and nobody really knew about it but me and the Lord, you know. And I'd say, okay, God, I got to get through this. Help me get through it.
But wasn't that a heavy burden?
It was.
To kind of hold on to.
It was. And it was, I think the heaviest part of it was to be secretive about it, mm-hmm. and not to let anybody know about it. I had people who sang with me who had no clue.
Really?
And when I started talking about it, they were like,
What?
Yeah. You know, and so I kept it for, you know, as a secret for many, many, many years.
And you don't want to tell anyone that. I mean, it's that stubborn, like, internal struggle that you go through when you are at your lowest point in life, right? You don't want to share that with your friends and family.
Absolutely.
So in your book, I highlighted something that really spoke to me, and I want to read it to you. The year 2015 was a rough one for me. Mm-hmm. After stopping my medication in 2010 for no other reason than thinking I didn't need it any longer, the depression began to creep back in increments. Mm-hmm. It was so gradual that I didn't realize it was returning. Mm-hmm. By 2015, I knew that it was back. I just didn't want to admit it.
Mm. Yeah.
I want you to speak to the internal struggle and the stubbornness that you dealt with, not only personally, but professionally.
It's a struggle, I think, because of the stigma. You don't want that kind of thing saddled on you. And I used to say, well, you know, I write these songs of encouragement, these songs of healing, these songs of deliverance, and yet when I finish ministering to people about it, then I get off the stage and I'm dealing with the same thing.
Yeah.
And somebody told me, one of my psychiatrists told me, he said, you know, Richard, God didn't use anybody who was not flawed.
Yes.
Everybody was messed up. Mm-hmm. So who are you that you should be this perfect individual that, you know, you have to be perfect to be used? But he uses those who are broken. He uses those who are in pain. So, I mean, that encouraged me through that situation.
Another quote, which I'll sort of paraphrase, but you're talking about, you know, suicidal thoughts.
So
not only are you dealing with the depression and anxiety, but then there was an obsession that you had to do it. Day by day, it got worse until it was hard for me to get out of bed. Mm-hmm. By the time that Thanksgiving, the anniversary of my mother's death, and Christmas all came around, it had gotten very scary. Spending days upon days watching videos of people doing heinous things to themselves because you wanted to go out painlessly. I did read that. You wanted to go out.
I didn't want to hurt.
Right.
And I didn't want to be maimed. And I said, you know, I was tired of it. It was hurting. I was like, what can I do? And for some reason, you know, you can find anything on YouTube.
Yes.
And I started watching these videos about people committing suicide, jumping off of buildings, shooting themselves, hanging themselves, things of that nature. And I typed in, how can I commit suicide painlessly? And a notice came up on the screen and said, call the suicide hotline immediately.
Yes.
And that broke me out of it.
Yes.
Ran to my phone in tears, called my therapist. She said, what's wrong? I said, I need help. She said, come on in now. Come on in, you know.
Mm-hmm.
So thank God for my family, my friends, and those who love me.
Yes.
Through it, you know.
Yes.
Yeah.
Amen.
Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah, go ahead, Claude.
And, you know, although you were dealing with some very serious issues, at any point of time, did you feel a sense of guilt in reference to your mental health issues?
I did. I mean,
why did you take on guilt with that?
Well,
why did you feel if it was your fault? Why would you be? Why did you feel guilty?
I don't know. I think being an African-American male, being in the African-American church, it's like, well, you're possessed by some unknown demon.
Yes.
We got to pray it out to you. And I'm like, well, God, why can't I get rid of this? I'm praying about it. Why am I getting delivered about it? You know? So I think the guilt had a lot to do with that. And just the shame. I didn't want anybody to know. You want people to think you're okay, but not saddled with some kind of mental illness.
Right.
You know?
So what about the church and all of this? I mean, you just mentioned the church, you know. you always hear, girl, pray through it.
Right.
But, yeah. I always say God and therapy.
Yeah. Absolutely.
You know, yes.
Absolutely.
And with you being so transparent now, how many people have come up to you?
I cannot tell you how many emails I get, how many texts I get, people coming up to me after concerts on the street saying, thank you, I've dealt with this all my life, I didn't know what to do. And even now, you know, I've been called to do conferences on mental health.
Good.
I'm like, I'm a musician, look at
you. Know,
but I'm grateful,
people, yes.
I'm so grateful, and I believe one of the reasons why I dealt with it is so that I could help others who are dealing with the same
absolutely.
Thing.
Richard, do you think the church should be doing more in regards to mental
absolutely.
Health? And what are some of those things that the church could be doing?
You know, I think each church needs like mental health conferences, clinics, parts of the church who deal with maybe live-in therapists and things of that nature who are part of the congregation. Yeah, things of that nature because people are suffering. And if you look around, we've lost so many people.
Yes.
So many people through suicide and things of that nature. Mm. So it's an epidemic proportion. And now with the young people, because bullying,
what I was about to ask
the bullying
on
the internet and social media, it's just like it's crazy.
Yeah.
What's your challenge to the young people, because one of the ones that you guys probably know, Charlamagne the God, he came out, you know, with his mental health book, and I don't see enough of that. Like, I feel like a lot of our black men are not in tune with the fact that they are hurting or are in pain, and you know, they look to who on the internet? They look to other people who may not be addressing the issues. What's your challenge to young men who may be facing these issues?
Well, I think for African-American men, it makes them feel weak and that they're not strong enough. You know, we're supposed to be these strong individuals, but all of us are suffering with something, you know, and my thing is talk about it to your friends, find two or three people you can talk to, but more than anything, get help. Get out there, get a therapist. Some of the things that we're dealing with at whatever age we are now are things that have come from when we were five, six years old, seven years old, those
trauma.
Kind of things. And if you don't ever deal with it, you it sort of eats at you for the rest of your life.
And so it can come out in the wrong way.
Absolutely.
But let me, we're so happy. This was a very deep conversation. But what brings you joy before we let you go? What brings you joy?
Music.
Amen.
Brings you joy.
Yes. That's all the praise music. Brings us all joy.
Music brings me joy.
Good. Well, we're so grateful for your transparency, your vulnerability.
Absolutely.
You are saving so many lives
by
writing this book and presenting it to the world.
Total
Please
praise.
Make sure
God bless you
get this brand new book by the one and only Richard Smallwood. Mm. And if you or someone you know is experiencing suicidal thoughts, please do not be silent. Call the suicide hotline right now, 1-800-273-8255. Thank you so much for being here today. We appreciate you. Again, you can get his new book, Total Praise, wherever fine books are sold.
Absolutely.
Next up.